It is possible to send animated populate characters from 3ds Max to Stingray. The best results involve characters that are animated in place, idle, so that the looped animations are predictable and easy to control. There are a few things to consider before you start. First, it is best to process your characters individually and not have them bound to a particular scene. In this particular example, it is very easy to be influenced by the scene and create a sitting character on the bench, or a standing character near the bus stop. Doing either would create characters that are fairly far from the 000 origin of the world, and that may create issues in Stingray. Even though a character and its skeleton are self-contained within 3ds Max, in Stingray, an invisible bounding box would make them dependent on the origin point. This would create issues when manipulating and previewing the character in Stingray. It is therefore best to start in a blank scene, and then add and place characters in Stingray where you need them. Creating populate idling characters in 3ds Max is quite easy and has been covered in many other tutorials on this channel. You simply use the ribbon and the populate tab to create idle areas with a simple click and drag, making sure they are close to the center of the world. Gender identifiers appear in pink and blue colors. Depending on the idle area size, you may get individual characters or groups. We'll settle for a single character for now. To generate a character and simulate its motion, use the Simulate button on the ribbon. By default, the simulation runs for 300 frames. The longer it is, the more taxing it becomes in size and in complexity. Let's use 100 frames in this example. Once the character is generated, play back the animation and notice the jump between the last and first frames as the animation loops. We'll revisit this problem shortly, along with various ways to fix it. More characters, single or groups, can be created similarly. There's also an option to create seated characters. A reference box makes it easy to place and orient the character. Again, make sure it is close to the center of the world. A character's general appearance can be changed using the Regenerate button on the ribbon. The resolution of the characters is quite low by default. This is by design, in case you want to create a few dozens in your scenes. However, you have the option to switch to higher resolutions using the appropriately named button on the ribbon. The first time you use this tool, you'll be prompted to download and install a high-resolution package in order to use this functionality. From there, you can toggle between low and high-resolution characters with a click of a button. The geometry becomes more detailed, but it's worth noting that the bitmap associated with the character changes as well. It switches from a low 256 by 256 pixel resolution to a far more acceptable 1024 by 1024 pixel resolution. Similarly, you can change the character's motion if you're not entirely happy with the one that was generated. The Re-Simulate button cycles through a series of random motions, and you can choose the one that works best for you. To export the animated character to Stingray, you first need to bake its animation to its skeleton. Keep in mind that once you do that, you won't be able to change the animation or even the character's appearance or resolution as you did before. Once you are ready though, you can bake the animation by selecting the character and using the Bake Selected button on the ribbon. This makes the character's skeleton visible and you can expand and see its hierarchy in Scene Explorer. With any given populate character, the topmost parent that contains animation data is the COM1 object. If you were to select that object, or any of its children, you'll be able to see the animation keyframes on the timeline. Again, you can see by playing the animation that the first and last frames show totally different poses, thus creating a jump in the motion. We'll explore two different ways of dealing with this issue in a moment. First, you need to export the animated character to Stingray. For that, you want to ensure you select all the animated skeleton's nodes. The easiest way to do that is to select the topmost parent that has animation data, COM1, and then right-click and choose Select Child Nodes. With the Control key pressed, you also want to select the character's geometry in the viewport, as this is ultimately what you will be looking at. Assuming Stingray is running and a Stingray project open, you can send the selected character using the Stingray menu. First, ensure the Connect option is enabled, and then with the character and skeleton selected, choose Send Selection. When prompted, save the file to disk, preferably under your Stingray working project. When prompted for more options, you mostly want to ensure the Animation and Skeleton option is enabled. By default, the New or Update Skeleton option is enabled. That's a good thing, as you will need this in Stingray to apply an animation controller. The Import Clips option is equally important, since you want to use the animation information you're importing from 3ds Max. The Create Animation folder is really optional and depends on how you like to organize your files. You can disable it if you prefer to store the animation file in the same folder as the skeleton and the mesh. As you see in this example, the scene in Stingray is the same as the one you saw in 3ds Max at the beginning of this movie. You want to add your character and place it in the scene on the bench. With Populate characters, my advice would be to verify the culling properties of the geometry. In some cases, the geometry of the character may pop in and out based on zooms and pans, which makes for a very annoying behavior. To prevent that from happening, double-click the thumbnail that represents your character's geometry or unit to open the unit editor. There, you can select the mesh of your character and switch the culling value to disabled. Exit the dialog and save the changes. Update the changes on the thumbnail. Note that at this point, the character is not animated just yet. To see the animation you imported from 3ds Max, you first need to add an animation controller to the skeleton. This can be done with a right-click on the skeleton's thumbnail. Once you have named and confirmed the creation of the controller, you can double-click it to edit its behavior. By default, there's an empty clip. Delete it and replace it with the one coming from 3ds Max. Save the changes to refresh the preview window and analyze the results. By default, the animation loops and, as anticipated, there's a bad jump between the last and first keyframes. Disable the looping properties and save again. Also as anticipated, this time the animation runs once and then stops. To induce a loop that you can control, drag the center of the motion clip to the right until you create a transition that loops back to the same clip. As a condition, you want the transition to happen at the end of the animation itself. Save the changes again. This time, the animation loops and there's a linear transition that happens between the last and first frames. It is somewhat fast in this case, so change the blend duration value to about 1 and try again. This seems to work much better. Exit the dialog when done. All that's left to do is to drag the newly animated character and place it in the scene. It will show animated in the viewport, but also at the thumbnail levels of the unit and the animation clip. The transition worked well here because the character's feet in this particular case were well planted on the ground. If the position of the feet changes between the last and first frames, then there may be some sliding involved in the transition. In that case, you may need to do some cleanup work in 3ds Max before exporting to Stingray. In 3ds Max, consider the lady standing and idling about. Scrub the animation and note the lady's feet. The position of the feet is quite different between the beginning and the end of the animation. Use the same process as before to to bring this character into Stingray. You can see a significant slide of the feet as the animation loops. To prevent this effect from happening, you need to minimize the offset position of the feet between the first and last frames of the animation. You can do that in 3ds Max with a bit of adjustments to the keyframes, mostly by copying and reversing part of the animation. This is done by first selecting all the bones that have keyframes. You also may want to extend the animation temporarily to give yourself some wiggle room. You also need to enable the Show Selection Range option with a right click, as this will help you manipulate keyframes. Select all the keyframes on the timeline, and then hold Shift and drag any of them to the right to copy the set. Next, drag the selection range left handle and swipe it to the right to reverse that clip. Keep an eye on the bottom left corner to keep the scaling at 100% so as not to affect the speed of the animation. You can then slide the selected keyframes back into position. You can also fine-tune the beginning, middle, and end sections for slower transitions. If you need to, adjust the total animation length yet again. All this ensures that the beginning and end keyframes are now exactly the same, and playback will result in a seamlessly looping animation. You can, in fact, already see this in 3ds Max by playing the animation. Select all the animated bones and the character's geometry and send them back to Stingray, overwriting the existing file. The data is updated, and you now have an idling character with a motion that loops seamlessly. Once you have an animated character behaving properly, you may ultimately want to use it in another Stingray project. For that, you can export an asset in a package that contains all the relevant information from geometry to skeleton to animation. All you need is to right-click the unit's thumbnail and choose Export Assets. A dialog shows you all the dependencies, including animation data, as well as materials and textures. When you export that content, you create a smart asset that is stored to disk and self-contained. All you need to do from that point on is to simply import it and place it into a different project. You wouldn't need to redo the setup work you did earlier. This workflow is easy and quite important when sharing your assets between colleagues and clients, or even selling them online.